So the question is, how do we know if somebody has awakened? How do we know if somebody has realized the true nature of mind, or attained awakening, or realization? Now, can we just rely on what people say? Because if that's the case, then there are many hundreds of thousands of people who are realized, who are awakened. In fact, being awakened or being realized is something quite commonplace, because everybody and their dog is claiming to be realized these days on YouTube. And so if we can't rely on just what everyone says, on their own personal opinion, then what's the best thing for us to look at? Well, it's my position that if we look at a universally renowned master of the past, who is held by all various different schools and traditions to have been accomplished or realized, when we look at their life story, then we should get a very good idea of what it means to be awakened. What sort of qualities does an individual who has become awakened have or show on the outside? So if we take as an example Patra Rinpoche. Now Patra Rinpoche is universally accepted by all Tibetan Buddhists, and also Buddhists from many other traditions. They all see him to have been a great and realized master. And he was a master. He was a master of the Dzogchen tradition. And he wrote the seminal text, The Words of My Perfect Teacher, that is a preliminary instruction to the Dzogchen tradition. So Dzogchen, or you could say Mao Mudra, they're basically the same thing. The techniques are a little bit different, but the realization and the practice are basically the same. So if we look at the story of Patra Rinpoche, then we should be able to get a good idea of what somebody who is enlightened behaves like, how they appear to us ordinary beings. So one, do they claim realization? Do they make it obvious, or do they go around telling people they're realized? Do they go around asking people to come listen to them, say, I'm a realized master, please listen to me, I'll tell you how things are. Is that what they do? If we look at Patra Rinpoche's life story, then he used to wander from place to place, a bit like a beggar. He looked like an old man wandering through the wilderness on foot, which is generally something only poor people used to do. If you had any money or wealth, then you would travel by yak or ride on horseback. But Patra Rinpoche never did this. He didn't do this out of respect for the animals themselves, because he had great compassion, but also because it's inappropriate for a monk, an ordained monk, to ride a steed or to ride an animal. So Patra Rinpoche used to walk, and because he used to walk and he looked like a beggar, then nobody thought he was anything special. Now, at some point on his journey, he came to a small hamlet, and there was maybe a small monastery, little temple, you know, little stone building. He went knocking on the door, trying to find somewhere to sleep for the night. And a lama came to the door, and he saw this poor, disheveled old man. So this lama obviously thought that Patra Rinpoche was an old beggar or a tramp. And he thought if he advised him in the Dharma, then it might help or improve this old man's life. So he had a good motivation, but he did look down on Patra Rinpoche. He thought he was a bit kind of lowly. What was the text that he taught Patra Rinpoche? Well, it was none other than Words of My Perfect Teacher. So he opened up this book, which everyone in Tibet sees to be so special and so important, and started teaching Patra Rinpoche. Now, if this was us, if somebody was trying to teach us our own book, how would we react? Or if we were a learned scholar, let's say somebody who's got a PhD, or one of these spiritual teachers who's written many self-help books, and somebody would say, look, you're a bit pathetic. You listen to me, I'll teach you some Dharma, and that will improve your life, and started reading their own book, then most likely they'd get offended. They'd be quite upset. Even if they didn't get upset, then they would probably be, wait a second, that's my book, I wrote that. I know everything about this book, you can't teach me anything about it. That's not how Patra Rinpoche reacted. Patra Rinpoche sat and looked at the lama with great faith and devotion, with tears welling up in his eyes, and utter gratitude that this old lama should be teaching a new Dharma. The old Lama had no idea who Pat Rinpoche was. He thought he was just an old man. So from this we can see it's quite clear that Pat Rinpoche didn't go around declaring that he was awakened. He didn't even claim to have written this book that's so famous. It's famous to this day. There's many, many editions of this book. You find it everywhere in English and many languages. So he didn't even lay claim to having written this book, let alone go around claiming that he was realized. But he was realized. He had realized the highest view, the Dzogchen view, and he also had experience in the Vajrayana, in the actual practice of Vajrayana. He was very learned, he was very realized, and most people saw him to be a Buddha. But when he wandered around in the mountains, and nobody even knew who he was, he just looked like an old tramp. For example, one day he was traveling to the city of Dege. It's like a kingdom. He'd been invited to give an empowerment, you know, give a Dharma talk, because he's very famous. And he always went on foot. And on his journey, then he met an old woman with a child. And she was very distraught. What had happened is that they were traveling together. The old woman and the husband and the child were traveling to the city of Dege to get an empowerment from Pat Rinpoche. But the husband had been killed by a bear, a wild animal, and now she was on her own. And so from that day onwards, Pat Rinpoche traveled and accompanied this old woman and carried her child on his own back and lit the fire, helped her find food, etc. And she had no idea who he was. And they traveled together like this for many weeks, or however long it takes to cross the mountains to get to the city. And then when they were approaching the city, he said that he would have to leave her now. I'll have to leave you now because I've got something important to do. He couldn't be seen traveling into the city with this woman. They were sort of, they looked like an old couple, man and wife. And also he didn't want her to know who he was. So he didn't declare that he was this famous Lama. And she was actually going to see him herself. And he slipped off quietly, and he went into the city to prepare for this empowerment, this great gathering. And of course, there were people traveling from far and wide. You know, thousands of people would come if they heard Pat Rinpoche was teaching. And he got up on the throne, and he started doing this empowerment. And the old woman was right at the back, because there were so many people. So she didn't see, through the whole empowerment, the whole teaching, didn't see who Pat Rinpoche was, didn't get close enough. And in the end, then, as she got closer to get a blessing, she realized that it was him, the person who had been traveling with him for so long. And normally what happens in these kind of empowerments is that people will bring money, food, silk, anything of value, and they'll offer it to the Rinpoche. So how did Pat Rinpoche treat wealth, for example? Well, he got all this stuff. And at the end, then he donated it all to this old woman to help her because she lost her husband. And he only kept as much as he needed to eat. Some dried meat, some tsampa, which is like a flour they eat, you know, some butter, just what he needed to carry on his journey, and gave all the rest of it to this old woman. And this is a general sign of somebody who's realized how they treat wealth and money. I mean, there's another story. When Pat Rinpoche was traveling, then there was a thief in the area, like a robber. And this robber had seen him making fire, campfire, and traveling through the mountains. And so he decided he would follow him. And when Pat Rinpoche made a campfire, then a rich merchant had come to see him because he knew he was in the area and brought him a gift, like an offering. And it was an ingot of silver, like a lump of silver. Didn't have money in Tibet in those days. Didn't have notes and coins. So if you had some wealth, then you would have a piece of gold or a piece of silver. So this is very, very valuable. And the thief, the robber, could see this rich merchant giving this valuable silver ingot to Pat Rinpoche and thought, the old man's got something, he's got some money. I'll follow him. It'll be easy to take it off him. He's just an old man. So the merchant left. Pat Rinpoche went on his way. And the robber followed in hiding. And then in the night, Patrick Ribichet made a campfire and went to sleep, and the robber thought, well, I'll get up early and I'll go and rob him. I'll steal the silver. But when he came down to the campsite, Patrick Ribichet had gone. The fire had been doused and he'd left. But the thief saw, lying at the side of the fireplace, where Patrick Ribichet had made the fire, was this silver ingot. He just discarded it in the ashes. He had no interest in the money whatsoever, even though he was poor. I mean, he only just had enough to eat. But still, he just discarded it. He had no interest whatsoever. So it's not like he's going to go around giving Dharma teachings and say, I'm in town, I'm a realized master, I've got the solution to all your problems, come see me, you know, $3,600 a week, sort of thing. He had no interest in money. And this is a sign of somebody who has realization, because they have no concern for worldly aims. Wealth, position, stature, name, you know. He didn't go around declaring he was a high lama. He didn't dress up, he just dressed like an old beggar, like a poor person. And another thing is, Patrick Rinpoche had great love and compassion for all beings. Like I said, he wouldn't even ride an animal. He would walk everywhere he went. And only poor people walk, right? In Asia, it's the poor people who walk. But he was humble. He was a mendicant. You know? He was a renunciate. He had no interest. What's more, he didn't want to burden an animal. So there's a story about how Patrick Rinpoche used to practice. He'd been living in a cave for a while, and there's this flat rock nearby, on the side of a river. And every evening, he would go out when all the insects were out, and he would take off his clothes and lie down on this flat rock and feed himself to the insects. Horseflies, mosquitoes, you know, biting things, whatever they were. They have all kinds of stuff in the East, like leeches and stuff like that. He would actually offer his own body to these tiny, insignificant sentient beings. So how many of our teachers do that, right? Our teachers who travel from city to city, how many of them go out at night and feed themselves to insects? And yet they claim to be awakened, to be realized. And it's not only the life story of Patrick Rinpoche. You look at Milarepa, any of the great lamas. And they were very humble. They were very meek. They lived like beggars. They didn't live it up. You know, they didn't have personal possessions. And yet, they were the most realized beings, most accomplished masters that we know of in history. If you get a chance, then I suggest you take some time and look at some of these life stories. We call them accounts of liberation. It's a tradition in Tibet. They write stories about masters, where they came from, how they came to accomplish the Dharma, how they became realized, what they did when they became realized, what their enlightened activity was. They're very, very useful. In general, then for most of them, there is an impetus. There is something that caused them to seek enlightenment. And, for example, for Milarepa, that was renunciation. When he was young, he engaged in negative practices, and he murdered more than 30 people. And because of that, he had absolute 100% conviction that when he died, he was going straight to hell. And because of that, then he practiced with such vigor. I mean, he didn't have food or clothing. He was sitting out in the caves in the snow in winter, in the Himalayan mountains. Not even enough food to eat. He would just eat stinging nettles, you know, sort of green stuff that was growing around. Not enough to survive. Starvation diet. There's a story once when his aunt brought food to his cave. He had been starving to death in the mountains, he'd been practicing. And she brought food to his cave. But he was engrossed in meditation and he didn't want to distract himself from his practice, so he didn't come to the door. And she got fed up and she just left it. She dumped the food and stuff at the front of the cave, in the mouth of the cave, and left. And Milarepa just kept meditating. And so eventually, the animals and the birds ate all the food and he didn't get a single mouthful. That's how diligent he was. And it was already accomplished at that point. So as you can see, we're missing something here. Because we start off by thinking, well, you're already enlightened, you don't need to practice. But somebody like Milarepa is already enlightened, but he still continues to practice with great fervor and great diligence. And there's a reason for this, but most people don't understand this. It wasn't just Milarepa, it was all of them. They all had great diligence, and they applied themselves with great vigor to practice, to the point or the brink of death. It's the way it's described is, you need to meditate like your head is on fire. Like if your head was on fire, you would run to the ocean, right? To dunk your head in the water. You wouldn't wait for a second. That's how you should practice the Dharma. And the reason why they practice like this is because realizing the view is actually quite an early stage. Realizing the true nature of mind, you know, realizing non-dual wisdom happens on the first level. It's just at the point when you become liberated from samsara, from the first level. But the problem is that in order to undo countless lifetimes of habituation, then we have to practice with great vigor. From the first, second, third, fourth, it takes eons. The stage of realizing the view happens early on. And so somebody like Milarepa, Padre Rinpoche, even though they were realized masters, they still had great diligence. Like I say, our practice is all backwards. We start from the top with the highest view, and then we work down, and then by the time we get to be 70 or 80 years old, we think, what was that all about? We don't see the point in it anymore, become jaded. But the young people today, who are saying they're already awakened and they don't have to practice, are going to end up being those jaded people when they're 70 years old. I have no doubt about it, because I've seen it before. I've seen the people who were students of, you know, Krishnamurti, etc., who used to meditate in caves on the beaches, you know, with Satchinanda and things like that. And they did this for years and years and years. But because they never persisted and they never gained any kind of results, by the time they came to the end of their life, they no longer had any interest in spiritual path. They became numb. And that's what I see many people are like that. They've given up on meditation. They've become insensitive and numb, what we call jaded to Dharma. And that comes from misunderstanding what it's all about. And it comes, as I said before, it comes from misunderstanding what is progress on the path. What does progress look like? What does it involve? And so if you study these life stories, it's really beneficial for you, because you can see what somebody who is a very capable individual had to go through in order to attain realization. And then, unless you're a complete egomaniac, when you see somebody like Padre Rinpoche or Milarepa, who are very capable individuals, and you see that they had to go through so much hardship, you're not just going to rest on your laurels and take it easy. Of course, if you're an egomaniac, you're going to think, well, I'm already enlightened, I don't need to do anything. But it's not going to serve you well. I guarantee you, just give it 10, 20 years, you're going to be looking back and thinking, you know, what was that all about? What have I accomplished? Where do I go from here? You have to go back to stage one. This is the backwards practice of the West, or the circular practice. Start off by practicing non-duality, the Vajrayana, everything is purity, everything is equality. Start up there and pretend you already understand that. But as time goes by and you don't see any results from your practice, you haven't changed, you're still afflicted by emotional trauma, unhappiness, you still don't understand the meaning of life, and then year after year after year, you're going to become more insensitive to the Dharma. It's going to become like, well, this doesn't work. You know, I started at the top. I didn't change anything. So it must be faulty. Well, the Dharma is not faulty. What's faulty is your way of thinking about the Dharma. You got the wrong idea. That's what I'm trying to say. And I said before, don't watch my videos if you don't want me to challenge you. Because somebody who doesn't challenge you isn't being honest to you. And they're not working for your interests. They're not working for your benefit. Somebody who tells you everything's okay, you don't have to worry, everything's fine, you're okay as you are, is not serving you well. They're doing you a disservice. Well, I guess I've got nothing else to say on this. But I do encourage you to look into these life stories and to read them. I mean, they're entertaining for one thing, but there's a reason for that. There's a purpose for doing this. And so thank you for listening, and until next time, see you later.